You're listening to Health Professional Radio. Welcome and thank you for joining us. I'm your host, Neil Howard, and we're going to be having a conversation with Dr. Chris Anzalone. He's joining us here from Arrowhead Pharmaceuticals to talk about some results from their global phase 2 study of ARO-AAT. Welcome to Health Professional Radio, Dr. Chris Anzalone.
Thanks very much, Neil. It's great to be here.
Give us some of your professional background. What it is that you do, and talk about your role there at Arrowhead.
Sure. So my background started in science. I got a Ph.D. in biology, did a postdoc, and then left science and got into private equity and was really most interested in early technologies at the time, and then joined Arrowhead a little over 10 years ago. Arrowhead was a different company at the time. It was a nanotechnology holding company, and we sort of morphed it into a more traditional pharmaceutical company. And here we are. We focus on a method of silencing target genes called RNA interference, and I've been CEO here for a little over 10 years.
Yeah. Now, I understand that this phase 2 trial deals with a specific condition, AATD.
That's correct.
Okay. What exactly is that condition? Who does it affect?
Sure. So you and I and all of your listeners will make a lot of this protein, this enzyme called alpha-1 antitrypsin. And it does a number of things, including protecting the lungs against inflammation. And there is a certain gene mutation that we think about 100,000 or so people in the U.S. are afflicted with, and probably more like 120,000 or 150,000 in Europe. And what that leads to is a misfolding of this protein. And that's not a good thing. What that causes is it becomes very difficult for this protein to be exported from the liver where it's primarily made. And what that gives you is two things, really. One, it gives you low levels in circulation that can lead to lung disease. Now, there's a way to treat that right now. There is a replacement therapy that people can be on, and that in some instances can alleviate the lung disease that can progress later in life. The other thing that happens is because this misfolded protein can't properly get out of the liver, it causes inflammation in the liver over time, and there's no treatment for that. And that's what we are looking to target here. The liver makes about 2 grams of this a day, which is a heck of a lot of protein. So this can become very inflammatory over time. And the only way to treat this right now is liver transplant.
Now, you mentioned some stats in North America and in Europe. This is an extremely rare disease, is it not?
It's a rare disease. I would not term it an extremely rare disease, right? So it is an orphan indication as defined by the FDA. But it's a reasonably sizable population that just has no treatment options right now. And we thought that it was really tailor-made for our technology. As I mentioned early, we have a technology that allows us to turn off a target gene. And we know that it is this one misfolded protein that causes the liver disease. And so we surmise that if we can turn it off, we can alleviate that liver disease. And we have now shown that. And so we're excited to move this into a phase 3. A study, and looking forward to getting this to patients as quickly as we can.
Now, once this protein causes inflammation in the lungs, is it ever misdiagnosed as something else, or is it misdiagnosed in the liver as something, some other liver condition?
Yeah, that's a great question. The liver disease is we believe grossly underdiagnosed for a few reasons. The reason one is that it's not easy to diagnose. The standard liver panels don't really pick this up until later in the progression of liver disease. So many people have this silent liver disease, and we only see it until it's very advanced for them, and that's a problem. The second reason that it's underdiagnosed is that there's no treatment for it. And so physicians, often will not diagnose something or not look to diagnose something if there's no way to treat them. We think that if this treatment does go in the way that we believe it will, and this could be a powerful treatment for these patients, we think that the diagnosis rates will go up because physicians now have a tool to address it.
Obviously, inflammation in the lungs is problematic, but when it comes to this, some of these liver problems, are we talking chronic condition from here on out? I mean, with no treatment, what type of quality of life is a patient going to expect?
Yeah, so it's different for every patient, of course, but it's a progressive disease. You know, these patients make a lot of protein. It doesn't get out of the liver very well, and so that just sort of compounds itself. And so over time, this becomes severe. Now, some people have problems in their, you know, when they're young children. Some people have problems in their 20s. Some people have problems in their 50s. So it really depends when it manifests. You know, really depends upon individual patients. But it can be quite severe, and we know that patients can become cirrhotic and then can die of liver disease. You know, one of the things that was really fascinating that we saw was after only 6 months of treatment with this experimental drug, we looked at four patients, and after only 6 months of treatment, two of them had a reversal of fibrosis. And in fact, those two were cirrhotic, and so we rescued them from cirrhosis. This is a very severe liver disease. After a year of therapy, four or five of the individuals that we looked at had a regression of fibrosis. And that was stunning to us. And frankly, I think stunning to the medical community because you don't generally see, you know, liver healing itself that rapidly. And it's a real testament, you know, to our ability to turn off this gene. And frankly, it's a real testament to what this technology can do. You know, when there is a disease that is caused by a single, you know, protein, we can often turn that protein off. We can often silence the production of that. So we think it's a really good harbinger of where we can take this technology going forward.
You mentioned the only treatment being a liver transplant. What are the odds of new livers developing the same type of thing in that recipient?
It should not be the case. Once they have liver transplant, unless they got a transplant from a person with the same mutation, which would be unlikely, then they should not have it again. But there's a whole host of long-term issues that a transplant recipient is going to have, you know, being on immune compromised, you know, for quite some time. And so, you know, if we can keep people from getting liver transplants, that's a good thing.
Now, I understand that ARO-AAT is being evaluated in a couple of phase two trials. Is that correct?
That's correct.
You mentioned that after 4 months, there were some positive results. After 6 months, were those in separate trials?
Right. So we have one trial that is open label, and so we're able to see data as they come in. In that study, we were looking at patients after 6 months of therapy, and then after 12 months of therapy, different patient cohorts, different patients in those two groups, of course. But we were able to see how the drug is acting. We have a much larger study that is blinded, and so it's placebo controlled, and so we won't know what happened in that study until that's complete. Now, that's fully enrolled, and so we should have data sometime next year, I believe. But the data that I described came from the open label study. And we expect to have discussions with the FDA this year about how we can accelerate our path to approval, because we think this is an important medicine for these patients who, again, just don't have any other options at this point.
So how significantly do you think the treatment landscape for this condition will change in about a year or so once you complete the trials and go for FDA approval?
Oh, it's going to be night and day, I think. You know, at least so far, this drug appears to be well tolerated, and so we just don't see safety issues that are concerning to us. So it appears to be quite active. You know, we are seeing a cessation of the production of this protein that is drastic, right? You know, after a year of therapy, we are seeing, you know, between 77 and 97% reduction of the protein within the liver. And so it's doing what we want it to do. And we are seeing a reversal of fibrosis in those patients with fibrosis. And so it's doing exactly what we want it to do. And we just don't see any real speed bumps here. We just need a bit more time to treat patients and to gather more data. But we think that we have something that could be really helpful for these patients.
Chris, give us a website where we can learn much more about Arrowhead Pharmaceuticals and about these trials as well.
Sure. Go to arrowheadpharma.com and you'll be able to look into our company and see what kind of studies we're doing. You can look at our base technology. You can look at our various clinical studies. We've got a very large pipeline for a company our size. And so while ARO-AAT is a drug candidate that we're excited about, we have many others that we're also excited about.
Well, I sure appreciate you spending time with us this evening, Dr. Anzalone, and I'm hoping that we'll speak again. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Neil.
You've been listening to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard, in conversation with Dr. Chris Anzalone, President and CEO of Arrowhead Pharmaceuticals. Audio copies of this program are available at hpr.fm and healthprofessionalradio.com.au. You can also subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, listen in, download a SoundCloud, and be sure and subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/healthprofessionalradio.